This is SP, and I'm here with the man behind the blue wall, Nev. How are you?
Boom, look who stepped in the room. I'm doing fine. Thank you, SP, for checking on in. What up, Vern?
What up, what up, what up, what up? Thanks for having me.
So, I'm gonna start just like we always start. Where you from? What's your background?
Well, I'm from California, South Central Los Angeles. Shit, as far as the music background, I can't even really trace it. Been doing it so long, but yeah, I've been doing it for a minute. More or less, just going through the motions. Been living through the era, seeing how things change, and just trying to find my space in it and do what I do.
Were you born in South Central?
Yes, born and raised.
So, you know, we've seen the movies and, you know, all of that stuff. But what was it like growing up in South Central?
It was, when you home, you kind of just, it's not what it looks like to somebody that's not from there. It's kind of, it's odd as it seems, it's normal. You get used to all the chaos. The gang banging, the shooting, the dope. It's just, you at home, it's just what you experience and what you're used to. But I mean, it's a wild campus. There's a lot of pictures on it. And I think it's a unique experience coming up in the era I came up in. I was born before crack, but I was an adolescent when that shit was popping around, and it changed things around the neighborhood drastically. And, it was just different, but you know, anybody that's from any ghetto could probably relate to how it is growing up in South Central Los Angeles.
Was it, how does it affect you in the way you make your music?
Well, it's the background to my story. You know, mm-hmm. it was the white noise or the canvas or whatever you want to paint it. Everything that I experienced, I pretty much experienced there. And, you know, from where I started with the music to where I am now. Now I just kind of tell it in a reflective tone, trying to, you know, like flashbacks and try to give you a little lesson from what I've seen throughout my time there. But it plays a huge part in my music because it's my environment. I'm that kind of rapper or that kind of artist where I draw from the environment and try to paint the picture from where we're from and give you a little different perspective that's already been out there from other artists. But it's a huge part to my shit.
They had a debate about people saying that they're from Atlanta and they're from the surrounding suburbs. South Central LA is one of those places that everybody says they're from, even though they're not from there. Do people in South Central feel a certain type of way when they hear somebody say they from South Central and you know they're not from there?
I mean, for me personally, I can speak for me. I think it's kind of funny. Like, you know, a lot of these artists claim to be from the turf, but they like was on the outskirts in the valley where the conditions were different. They might have had cousins that lived there or, you know, or their grandma probably was still down there or something. So it's kind of hard to parse if they really from there. They may have got some of the experiences. Some of them might be outsiders looking in, just telling it from a different place. But I just think it's funny for anybody that don't understand that they were blessed not to be from there and the one to, you know, embrace that when they didn't have to. Because I don't think nobody would choose to go through the shit we go through down there if you didn't have to go through it. You know what I mean? I would love to have been born in Beverly Hills or somewhere affluent, you know, that had a better environment and better conditions. It's just the luck of the draw. But I think it's funny, it's interesting. I think it's weird when you don't know you're blessed. Like if you're from somewhere better, that was safer and had better schools and better environment, you should be proud of that because that's something to be proud of too.
Yeah, I think it was OC who said that that he grew up in the house and he found himself being ashamed of actually growing up in the house with both his parents at home. And he wondered what is wrong with us that we would want to be. It's like a badge of honor.
Well, you know, it's just a weird thing. You know, I've never claimed to be somewhere or be from somewhere I wasn't, or claim a lifestyle that I never have or I didn't experience. But, you know, people are wired different. And, you know, especially in this day and age, everybody is more about status than being a solid individual. It's more about what people think you are rather than what you really are. So, you know, I don't understand the psychology behind it, but, you know, it is what it is.
Vern, who are some of the MCs that you know of that do come from the South Central area specifically? The one that comes to mind is Cube, but I might be wrong. But who else comes from South Central itself directly that you know of?
Well, some of my, like you said, Cube is one of my favorites that's directly from there. Dub C would be from there. You had Ahmad, he was from South Central. Nipsey was from South Central. Shit. Dub C. Shit.
It's a great Nip. You just said the great Nip. I just thought of that when we were talking off camera of everybody, and I was like, wait a minute. I didn't even talk about Nipsey. So look, rest in power to the great Nip. One of my favorites, too, man.
Exactly. Clip, I mean, just cut short, man, the potential of what could have been, right? But, I mean, this
is... You know him?
No, I not personally, but my brother lived in that neighborhood down the street from the store and where Nipsey was from, and also... I'm familiar with the area and people from over there and all that. I didn't know him personally, though.
Inspirational dude, man. Very inspirational man. He had vision.
It was a different look. It was definitely a different look, and he had a different way of thinking, and not just thinking, it was really, you know, happening. You saw what he was doing if he was, you know, over here. You seen the shit going on in the neighborhood that he was really talking about, that was really happening. So, you know, hopefully the family and all that can keep it going to the best of their ability. But yeah, definitely a different dude. Definitely a different dude.
You know what's interesting? This will be my last one, SP. Sorry. You know what's interesting? I was thinking about this during Black History Month. People say that sometimes visions and dreams die with the leader, or the movement dies with the leader. Just what do you think when a person like him passes away or whatever? Do you think that the movement can carry on and tradition carry on?
Well, I mean, when you lose the face of the movement, it would never be the same. But I believe that the family is still, you know, I know they just opened up some new stuff in the neighborhood and they're still pushing the agenda. So I can say, hopefully it continues, you know, but Jesse Jackson wasn't Martin Luther King, right? So it is what it is, but, you know, hopefully they could continue to do the good work that they was trying to, that he started, and that's all we could hope for.
That part, that's what's up. Oh, I see. Yo, no joke too, man, on the real, I peep your jewels, man. Salute, them jewels are tough. I was watching the Kanye joint, the documentary. He has that piece that I think he has both pieces similarly, actually. That's ill. I didn't even peep that.
Man, yeah.
The same jeweler.
Yeah. Got to treat yourself a little bit.
So, let's talk about your new project, Distance Travel.
Okay, let's get into it.
I really enjoyed this album. What inspired you to make this album?
Well, Distance Travel is pretty much a complete new experience for my people that's listening to it, and it was for me as well. I got with some fellas that I've been knowing for a few years that got a production company called Nothing to See Here, and they just operate on a different level. Everything you've heard from me previously, I've done pretty much in the vacuum and bubble. I do my own thing here, or, you know, I work kind of isolated, and this is the first time I kind of opened up and had different hands in the pot. And it came from me having to travel from Bakersfield, from where I live, back to LA from Thursdays to Saturday and Saturday nights. And it just hit me for the time, like, you know, I'm putting all these miles in and, you know, still got a kid to get to school in the morning and all the shit that I got to do in my regular life. And I'm like, this distance travel, it's symbolic, you know, from where I was as an artist to where I am now. And it's literal because I put a lot of fucking miles in getting this shit done. So that was the inspiration, just, you know, just trying to open up and have people input different ideas and work a different way and kind of, you know, approach the music a different way.
So the first thing I noticed, that was the first thing I noticed about this album is it sounded different.
Mm-hmm.
It sounded like LA.
Yeah.
A lot like LA. But still, it had a little bit of a Snoop Dogg vibe to it, where you were dropping gems, but I was still, you know, bopping. I wanted to hear it in my speakers.
Right, right. Well, I think music, as far as the soundscape, I definitely know this is my most ambitious effort as far as that goes. Like, these guys, they implement a lot of live instrumentation over the production, and it's just different elements that I haven't even experienced. Like, today was the first time I really listened to it in my studio out loud, bro. And it's the same for me. Like, it's substance in there, but you could just vibe to it too. You could just, you know, get from point A to point B, and you might even miss what I'm saying because it's just so well produced. You know what I mean?
What made you go outside of what you normally do? The one thing I know about you is I never know what I'm going to get per album.
Right.
It's always a surprise. This was definitely a surprise. How did you step outside of your box and actually start collabing?
Well, I felt like I at the point where I started working on this, or I got the opportunity and to work on this, I felt like I had a wall as far as the way I've been doing things. It wasn't doing nothing for me as far as my spirit, the way I was working. It wasn't enough energy. You know, you can only do so much on your own or in your own space without, you know, bodies around just to give you a different energy. So when opportunity arose to work with different people that had, we got mutual admiration for each other's work, it was a no-brainer. And it was a way to work different. You know, I wasn't recording at my house. I was going to another studio, and it was like different. I didn't have the final say, but it wasn't just my idea on the table. It was different ideas, and other people had input on everything from the artwork to the song structure to arrangements, everything. So it was just a different, I got to sit back for one and just be the artist. I didn't have to mix nothing. I didn't have to do shit, but write the songs and do what I had to do. So it was a better experience for me. Definitely changed how I'm gonna do music going forward.
So being in the studio with the actual producers at the time, it seems like a better fit for you. I've watched you in your studio for years. And so to see you step outside of that and enjoy it is kind of next level for me, because you talked about it, but you had never taken this step, which is actually pretty great. How did you get into that mind frame to step outside of yourself, because you are an introvert most of the time?
Right. Well, it just, you know, you can, all right, say you cook a certain meal a certain way, right? And you do it the same way every time. And it's always pretty good. You kind of get the same kind of response every time somebody get that meal. You kind of, and then you know other people that do cook the same meal you cook or similar. They cook like you cook, and they invite you over to, you know, kind of potluck. It was sort of like that. It's like I didn't have nothing else to do. I didn't got where I got with that recipe I've been using, so I just wanted to expand on it. And, you know, but I add, plus what they do, it just came together. And it's like you said, being in a room with the producers, it's ill because they produce some songs. Some songs were produced by other people, but they build upon them. You understand what I'm saying? Like they, like shout out to my man, Daryl Dion. He got a joint on there, but it was built upon. Smoke and Ace sent me something and they added live shit to that. And it was just amazing for me to see because I've never worked like that before. I've never even thought about doing it on my own or having it done. So it was just a completely new experience.
Shout out to Daryl.
Yeah. Get well, bro. Keep on keeping on.
When you first started to delve into producing, how big was that step and who kind of guided you along the way?
Well, I don't actually, like, I'm like Diddy and shit. I don't do nothing like hands-on. I have ideas and people do it for me. I engineer. I can mix and master the songs and make them sound like they're supposed to. But as far as constructing beats physically, I don't have the patience for it. I know what I want to hear. You know what I mean? So that works out that way, but I can't do it. Shout out to them dudes, because it's just, I don't even, like magic to me, seeing how they do that and all the steps and shit that takes. It's amazing to see. And then for people to take that what's already built in it and know what instruments to play over it and the key to play it in and how to bring it, you know, to life, it's amazing. It's an amazing thing.
What do you want the audience to kind of take away from this album?
Well, with all my work, I just want, for one, I want people to understand that music is vast, and it would be nice if people get out of the mindset that if it ain't fucking shoved down your throat, that it's not there and it's not good. You can find it, it's everywhere. And there's a lot of good artists with real substance and good music that you may enjoy if you just step outside of the programming. And as far as this album, I just want people to see growth. If you've been riding with me, I hope that you see that it's growth and I'm expanding. And if this is your first experience, I just want you to understand that I'm an older artist, so you shouldn't pigeonhole people and, you know, think music got an age restriction, and just be open-minded. If you enjoy it, share it. Tell people about it and help it grow. And if you don't, then I can't say nothing. It's not for you, it's not for you. But I just want people to understand that good music is good music. And if you enjoy it, it shouldn't matter where it comes from. It's not like a tennis shoe. It's not like, you know, something that needs a brand or something big. If it's good, it's music, it's organic, it's gonna feel good to you. And if it feel good to you, fuck with it.
How important do you think it is for, I so often hear that people always say, I'll just go back and listen to my 90s hip hop. How important do you think it is for us as an older generation to kind of step out of ourselves and delve into some newer artists and newer sounds?
Well, you know, I see this happen a lot with people that's a little older. And we kind of, you know, you got to kind of remember that we're real protective of the culture because we was the generation that we literally had to fight for it. And our parents wouldn't let us listen to certain things and, you know, all the shit we went through for this. But they got to also understand what was coming down on us when we was going through that. And you don't want to turn around from being oppressed to being an oppressor, right? And I mean, that's drastic as an example, but that's kind of what it is. A lot of people judge the shit without even listening to it, and then they lump everything into the same thing. And you should not do that because it's art. And these people are passionate about it. The people that support it are passionate about it. So you can't denigrate it. You can't just shit on it because you don't like it or you're not even open-minded to give it a chance. Everything grows. Everything's changed. Football's not what it used to be. Basketball's not what it used to be. It's a different game. It changes with the youth. You got to understand the youth push it. If you don't like it, then the alternative is get out and not be lazy because there are a lot of people doing things that you may like. You just got to look for it. And if you find it, support that. But there's no need to cast negatives on the stuff you don't like. If you don't like it, why are you speaking on it? Just let it be. Because they're working hard at what they're doing and they're passionate about it and their fan base is too. You got to be fair with everything. So I don't think, you know, and yes, support the 90s hip hop too. If you want to go back and support the shit you used to, they need them screams too. So yeah, do that too. But, you know, I just don't feel you got to piss on nobody else while doing any of that.
Can I still shit on Lil Pump?
I mean, of course. I said, I don't think you should, but I'm nobody to tell anyone to do what to do, you know?
With you, so when you get ready to pick a beat for your album, do you look for a specific sound for each project, or does the sounds come together for you and you hear it and make a project?
It kind of comes together. I don't aim. I have an idea after I get a couple of, like, if I got a blank slate, nothing's as far as a project in route. I just do songs, a couple of songs here and there, and then it kind of comes together like, okay, I'm going to do this way, or an idea to come or a concept to come, and then I'll just work within that. And then I try to just bring it all together. But that was the past. Now, next, going forward, I'm going to kind of have a little more direction and try to aim from the beginning and bring shit together in a different way. Now I got access to different things.
So as you have grown as an artist, just looking back from where you began to where you are now, what are the differences that you hear in your particular sound?
Well, you know, the quality as far as the finished product has gradually got better. And come on in. I'm doing the interview. The quality of the sound has gotten better, and you know, I see growth. When I took a 7-year break from music, and when I got back to it, I didn't really know where the ground was. I couldn't get my feet planted right, so I went through a couple of different, you know, iterations of things and a couple of different changes, trying to figure it out. But now I'm very, very comfortable in what I do and what I want to do, and you know, as far as my goals and this shit, so I don't move a certain way to try to grab a certain audience. I'm pretty good with my audience, and you know, I'm trying to work it that way and just grow it. So yeah, that's pretty much how that goes.
What was your first album when you came back 7 years ago?
It was this album called Don't Kill the Messenger. I don't know if I got this shit put up nowhere, but I can find it. Or I can put it back up. I can send it to you. But yeah, it was called Don't Kill the Messenger. And it was pretty good. After a 7-year break, I think it was a pretty good album. But, you know, I think things really kind of start taking shape with Serene. And ever since then, things kind of been, I kind of had an idea of what I wanted to do or what I was as an artist.
So this is the thing about Serene. Serene was the first time I saw you have patience.
Mm-hmm.
You were always so very rushed. And, you know, you would put a project out and put something else out and something else out and something else out. But Serene is, you can tell you took your time.
Yeah.
With Serene. What brought that about? What brought that calmness to you where you could sit on a project and wait for the most opportune moment to drop it?
Well, with Serene, when I started it, it was what it was, but then the world stopped with the whole pandemic thing, right? And unlike a lot of people, I understood what was going on as far as just you have to sit still for a minute and wait till the, you know, the world figure this shit out. And in doing that, I had a lot more fucking time on my hand to kind of just really sit. And I, you know, even if you remember during that time, the underground was winning. It wasn't none of that flashy shit or that mainstream shit really even coming out. They weren't even really releasing our music. It was the other people doing it, and it was a thing where I was just picking my spot. You know, it was so much content going on that there was so much happening within the pandemic, like the George Floyd and, you know, everything that was happening within all that time frame, that I kept getting content. So I couldn't never be like, okay, I'm finished, you know. And by the time I got to the point I was finished and, you know, was able to deliver it, it was just a good time. And it taught me that, you know, you don't have to rush because, you know, you can work a little different. Being older and, you know, just how this game, you know, is kind of constructed or was constructed, it's changing now. But I used to rush a lot because I felt like I was on the clock. You know what I mean? You only got so much time to kind of get this shit done because you're going to age yourself out. Fortunately, they're giving us a little more runway now. You're starting to see people have longer careers in hip hop. So I can slow down now because it ain't so urgent.
What do you feel about the ageism in hip hop?
Well, it's what happened. Well, from my point of view, is I feel like it just took a little time for us to, for the whole hip hop to grow up and grow. The original audiences that pushed it, like the first couple of generations to grow up and let their people grow up. Now, like with the Run DMCs, the VC Boys, that, you know, their audience kind of aged out kind of fast, but that was the first, you know, iteration of this. But as we grew, we're still able to support it economically and still able to enjoy it. And that's why some of our favorites, like the J's, the Snoops, the M's, they're still able to do it because we're still here, but it just took time. Ageism is always going to be a thing because young people ain't going to never think old people are cool. It's just what it is, you know what I mean? I mean, in certain lights, they can respect certain shit, but in other things, they can't. But they got to grow up to it. It'll even itself out, I think, as far as hip-hop eventually.
So, are you kind of like me when I see an older artist drop, I'm immediately going to hit the button. I want to see what they're up to.
If it's somebody I fucked with anyway, yeah. If not, then, you know, I get to it. But you know, I like the fact that they're around and they're dropping. And just because I might not immediately jump at it, I know there's some that are, you know, and that's the best part about it. You know, that there's an audience for it and they're able to do it. And with the way the world works and the internet and all this shit, and the way music is now, you're not constrained. You ain't waiting for nobody to put your music out. You put your own music out. So it's great to see. And I do check in. And one problem that I do see with a couple of people that you might consider a little older, I'm gonna call them contemporary, they don't adapt. They gotta adapt. Dude, I'm not saying you do what the young people do, but you gotta sonically kind of keep up with what the sound like. It can't sound old. That's at least in my opinion. You know, it can't sound old. It got to sound fresh and new. Current.
Yeah. Who do you think are some of the unsung heroes of the West Coast that people don't talk about nearly enough?
I would think, like, I don't think people talk about overall, I really feel like there's so much going on in the Bay that people don't even look at the Bay like that's the West Coast sometimes. Like, it's weird. The Bay got a whole different culture going on, so there's so much shit going on up there that people didn't miss. And, you know, I feel like, you know, from the back in the day, I don't feel like the Licks get get their flowers like they should. The Far Side don't get their flowers like they should. But it's just so much. Like, I don't believe people even understand how brilliant DJ Quick is. And it's incredibly odd that they missed that, because he's phenomenal. And it's just so much. But, you know, I've learned that it's just what it is. We're you know, this, like the second, then the sub, like they getting their shine now, and they've been doing that thing for a long time. But it's always been that way, because I'm sure I miss things on the East Coast, miss things on the South. I miss probably some things on the West Coast, but it's just a lot. Like, one thing I always hated was that they lumped it all in as one thing, like we sound one way, and that's never been the case. And there's, and if you can get past that, you'll find so many gems over here. And that's what I implore everybody to do, just try to kind of just, you know, dig around and look for some shit. It's been so much, and you, any error is there.
So if you had to introduce somebody to West Coast hip hop, where would you start?
I would give them three albums. I would probably give them Death Certificate. I would give them Souls of Mischief's first album. And I would probably, you know, either a Kid Frost or a Cypress Hill album, just so they can see the different layers. Because, you know, you got the Latin scene over here. Ice Cube, you know, that Death Certificate, I think it's probably one of the best, if not the best, albums to come from over here. And just the Souls of Mischief, just to show that there were people that was doing things that wasn't gangster rap. And it was happening too. And it's Oakland, it's the Bay Area, so they can kind of get the whole map and, you know, start digging around from there.
So when people talk about gangster rap, back in the day when I heard Ice-T 6 AM, I never considered it like gangster rap. I just thought that was like a Thursday.
Well, you know, they labeled it as such. So, you know, we play with what they called it. But all these people were doing was telling stories from their neighborhoods. Ice-T is just as gangster rapper as Mobb Deep would be. I mean, it's all relative. They're just telling stories, right? But then again, you know, you got Hollywood making millions and billions of dollars on these stories, same stories, you know, fucking, what would you call Casino? What would you call Heat? You know, it's the same thing. These people are telling stories. Is that gangster movies, or are they just movies, right? But, you know, that's how things were labeled. A lot of people, and it caught on, because after NWA, people seen there was a lot of money in these stories, and that's what they kind of concentrated on over here, and that's kind of how things got kind of lopsided.
I have to put an honorable mention with the albums before. I thought of Bizarre Ride to the Far Side.
Yeah.
That's fire, that album.
That album is, I mean, people don't even understand how influential the Far Side was to bringing J Dilla to the world. People don't even know that. Their second album was pretty much J Dilla. People don't even know that. They don't talk about that. They talk about how Q-Tip or whoever else, but it's just weird. That's just how it's been, you know?
Unsung heroes.
Look at Madlib. Nobody ever talked about
him. Oh my gosh. Yeah, fire producer. The Alchemist.
Alchemist. Yeah. Evidence. All them from here, man. J-Ro from the Licks. I mean, I could just go on.
J-Swift. Both dope producers.
It's Focus. It's Focus. It's Fred Rick. It's so many. It's so many. Battle Cat.
You know, man, legendary for sure. Producers are unsung, I think.
Look what Hit Boy is doing. Hit Boy pretty much revived Nas.
Definitely fire. A crazy run.
Crazy. So, you know, we do our thing over here, but I think now everybody kind of just mingle and get it. You know, everybody kind of give everybody their proper due now. It kind of grew out of that era where people was looking at where you from and kind of diminishing what you do. Everybody kind of work with everybody these days.
There's no more like East West Coast.
Nah,
really going on. That died down.
I don't think so.
So I've watched you on Twitter, well, actually across social media. You move different.
Yeah.
I like that you move different. How did you find your rhythm? Because it used to be so frustrating for you. How did you finally find your rhythm with the social media era?
You know what happened? I got a taste of a bit of personal success. Like I hit a goal and I figured out that you can't really control that world. You can just control how you move in it. And I decided to just take a couple steps back and focus more on the music and keep whatever's going on with me personally personal. Now, people that fuck with me because of the personal, and they already there, and they know how to reach me and get in touch with me and talk to me if they need to talk or whatever that case may be. So now it's just growing from that. Not really, you know, taking sides or getting involved in all the hoopla, because it's so much every day, and you got to kind of step outside of that, you know. I had to figure out that, you know, you're either going to be the one they're talking about or you're going to be the one in the stands talking about other people. So it's more or less, let me just, you know, as they say, the brand, and, you know, let me just push my product, push my art, and see how that worked out. And it seemed to be working out a little better, because I'm very opinionated, and that probably hurt me in the past.
But you, it seems like you're more relaxed and you're a little more focused when you're...
A lot more. I mean, it's because, you know, once you taste it, you see you can get it. You, like, everything that I envisioned, I can get it. I don't have huge aspirations. Not to say I'm aiming low, but I got a chance to see that, okay, if you kind of figure a way to get this done, you can do it, right? And that's just been the mission since. Like, okay, I seen I can taste it. Let's get it done. Let's go after it. So that's how we're doing it.
So what does success look like to you?
I mean, as far as, you know, personal goals, like I always got certain little numbers and, you know, little aspirations. But personal success is that I saw support in the real way. I seen people like really put their hands around the project, and people hit me with certain messages that they really helped them through shit. And, you know, it was a difference maker in a lot of spaces. And that's all I wanted to do. Now, on the big scheme, you know, it didn't do, you know, it wouldn't be considered much because, you know, it didn't hit world, you know, like that. But it hit in a way where I can build on it. And it was the first time that had happened. So once that happened, I see that, okay, all the changes in the planning and doing things a certain way is paying off. So I'm focused on that now. I can't really, you know, it's not like I'm shooting in the dark no more.
So, praying with dirty hands.
Shout out to Pop Rod. It is
an album that was done years before it came out, right?
Yes, right.
But the funny thing about that particular album is when I started to see a shift. Not only in you as a person, but in you as an artist. What was it about that particular drop? Even though it was a few years, it was a few years in the making to be dropped. Did you notice that change in yourself?
With that project, shout out to Polly Rob. He produced the whole thing. He's a staple out here on the coast. He's a lot more established than me. And he got his hands in a couple of different pots. And when, you know, we did the project and then the way we, you know, whatever the reason we is set, it just taught me, it was a patience thing. And, you know, I was, it was cool for him to come handpick me to do that, because he, you know, he does things like that. And once it dropped, you know, dealing with the people that know who he is, and it opened me up to a whole different audience. And once again, it was just an eye-opener on just how things kind of work when you're doing it the right way and not cutting corners. I felt like it was really a complete project, and it was something I hadn't able to do on my own at that time. I hadn't made anything as complete as that at the time on my own. So it kind of taught me how to, you know, go about things a different way. And it was just a dope experience working with somebody more established, and that opened a couple of different doors and avenues.
The album still touches me. I listen to it often. Because it was written so many years before, when it dropped, it was so relevant to the day. Do you think that it was so relevant to the day that it dropped? What do you say to people who are, hold on just a second.
She's, SP is a diehard fan of yours, and anything she says that she puts the stamp on, I'm like, let's go. Oh, yeah.
But we've been friends for a couple of years, yeah. And she's a good human being. You know, that's all that count with me, man. Connected with good humans.
And she's a supporter. She supports people.
Yeah.
No joke, you know. So that's once she said that this is something and it's dope and it's whatever, then I say let's go. Her, Maria, they are like they're the two music heads of the crew, like the real underground or whatever. Like they know up and coming, and whoever's been doing their thing, they definitely tapped in. And through Twitter too, they're like the Twitter heads. I'm just kind of getting into Twitter.
There's a lot going on that bird, man. It's a lot going on.
Especially in the music thing, for sure. Like, there's a movement. I didn't realize how serious the underground hip hop movement was on Twitter space. You know what I mean? I really slept. And I don't know if that picked up since the pandemic, but I really slept on how serious that movement is. Yeah, until hip-hop. I went in and I was like, oh shit, everybody's in. You can reach anybody.
That's the thing about it, man. It's you know, I made some pretty good contacts just existing on there.
Yes. And
the difference between, I guess you would say, like, I would always say Instagram is geared for pretty women more than anything else.
Yes.
I mean,
the IG model.
It's not a knock. It's just what it is. And, you know, it's just hard to kind of separate yourself in this music thing from the haves and the have-nots. And they try to put people in corners. And I don't ever understand it, because it's just music. You know, now if it's bad music, bad quality, then okay. But, you know, other than that, it's music. And yeah, you get the struggle rap and SoundCloud rap titles, or, you know, the internet rapper shit. And it's just weird. So, but Twitter, you
got Backpackers versus.
Right.
Yeah.
But you
sorry, what do you think about Twitter?
You can break through on there. Like,
yes, definitely. Yes. And sell your merch direct to consumer, no middleman. And the Bandcamp. Bandcamp, SoundCloud, and Twitter, I think, are definitely. I become the people's choice. You know, my practice and what I did, I joined, you know, the technology made it where now clients can pick me, and it got rid of that you need to have a job or I have to approve of you to be anywhere. The clients determine whether or not I'm worthy. Now with the musicians, I see it, it's the fans that determine whether or not you're worthy. Nobody else can tell you. You know what I'm saying?
Very point blank. That's exactly what it is.
Cuts out the gatekeeper foolishness.
Yeah, in a way. I mean, it's still, you know, roadblocks and all, but I mean, I just feel like if it's destined, it'll pop off, you know. You'll get there.
So, I forgot where I was going with that. So, we just gonna move on.
I forgot the last question. I did too. I forgot.
I know. My brain went on pause when them dogs started barking.
Do you remember the last question, Vern? What she was asking?
No, it's okay.
I know it was something about albums. No, production albums.
No, I was praying with dirty hands because that's praying with dirty hands and Serene are two of my favorite joints from you. Serene gave the audience a good picture of who you were, not only as an artist, but as a man.
Mm-hmm.
What do you, when you write an album like Serene, another part that I loved about it, it was your daughter.
Right.
What was a big part of that? Your ride or die, you know, I've watched her grow since I've been following you, and she almost feels like a part of the family.
Yeah.
How is it for you being you have a full-time job, you're a artist, and you're a father? How did you figure out how to balance all the things you're doing?
I have not. You know, you do what you do the best you can with it all. You know, you kind of prioritize it, you know, the best way you can, and you go for it. She's easy. She's an only child, and she's pretty self-sufficient and all, and she's supportive. And we don't get in each other's way as far as most things go. And, you know, as far as the job and all, I mean, I have my own setup, and I make time to get to other places to do what I got to do. But it's like with all things, I mean, you can't be a prisoner to your environment, to circumstances, if you want something. Most people that make it figure a way to make it happen. And that's all we all do. All of us as parents know that. And we all just taking it day to day and trying to figure it out.
No excuses.
None.
I like that. I like what he said. He said, you were saying that in a little break there, everybody has life going on, but they have to figure out how to situate themselves and position themselves to make things happen in spite of life going on, right? Because exactly. There's always going to be setbacks or situations happening, but you have to remain steadfast and focus on what your goals are and objectives are to really accomplish them.
Right.
And not sit back with a bunch of regrets.
Nah, I mean,
woulda, shoulda.
That's how you get them. If you don't try to make the moves, you will regret it eventually. You gotta at least take the shot.
100% of the shots that are missed are the ones that are never taken. SP, take a shot. Boom.
You are another part of the reason that I even have enough confidence to have actually even been a part of a podcast or start a podcast. I watched you and the way you didn't let things hold you back. I've watched you in pain, unimaginable pain. I've watched you going through even the legal system, and through all of that, I've watched you persevere. Where does that strength of will come from?
Well, my granny used to say life is for the living, and it's just basically the alternative is worse. Like if you don't push through, like you can look outside. I don't know how it is where you at, but out here you see tent cities, like people literally everywhere in tents, all wherever they can put them up at. And I mean, that's the thing for me, like as long as you can fight, you should fight, because if you don't, then you know what's next. It's horrible, and it's a bigger hole. So, you know, I mean, and I'm responsible for a person that depends on me. So you can't quit. You know, you have times of weakness. Everybody get tired. Everybody, you know, how they moments. But, you know, have that moment. Do what you got to do in that moment. Then get the fuck back up and go on and do what you got to do. Or don't. And see how that fit. I don't want to know how that fit.
Wow. I noticed that in New York. Like, it's not funny, but in New York, man, the homeless rate has definitely, you know, exploded in the subway system. We don't have tents, so to speak, but you just notice there's more violence. There's more like acting out, people getting pushed in front of trains. It's why. Do you think that the pandemic, well, from the pandemic, have you noticed tent city growing, so to speak, or things happening in the last 2 years that really have what's the word, accelerated certain things or blown them out of proportion? Or do you think it's the same for the same?
No, I think it's life, and that didn't help. There's a lot of new homeless. There's, you know, when you live in the world with a lot of people living check to check, and you know that thing happened, and they wasn't in the position to earn. They out there, and you know, plus the people that was already out there, and you know, when you shifting resources, you got to think that it wasn't a lot going on for the homeless when all these COVID tests and everything else was popping up. You got to take something from something to do something else. So, I think it's all just a combustible bag of misfortune. And yeah, it's getting worse because, you know, the differences between the haves and the have-nots is growing every day. So it's a bad situation all around. And I think the pandemic had a lot to do with it.
I'm a little ignorant to this, and I'm probably some of the viewers are too. Can you explain a little bit about what is going on with like California and the debt? You know, overall, like as a state, it seems like it's been in a bad financial situation for like over a decade, right? From the governator days till now. Can you, I don't know if you can or whatever, but what is that about?
Well, it's just, you know, a lot of industry shifted. Hollywood ain't really Hollywood per se here. Movies are being made different places. Like most places, we have, you know, local government that put money where they want to put it and take it from other places. So mismanagement, it's a lot of people here that can't afford to be here, and that contributes to it. It's a shift going on. And you know, with the fires and the homelessness and like the pandemic with everybody else, it's just a mess. I wouldn't know why it's that way, but yeah, it's been a mess for quite some time as far as the debt and the government and the local government, I guess you say the state government. California, it's a weird place, but I would say a lot of it is the Trump effect. It's just a lot of pulling in different directions and shit. But what's new?
So there's been a lot being said about being brought to light about the LAPD. Do you see any change?
No. I guess you could say anytime when, I mean, in the urban areas, at least, I guess that's what anybody's ever talking about as far as it's the inner city, because you don't hear too much complaints when it's in the other areas. Just to be fair, I mean, LAPD probably have a very complicated job dealing with, you know, what goes on in the inner cities of LA. But from what I've known my whole life, LAPD is just a shitty fucking department full of bullshit that we all know that they do a lot of recruiting from deep down south with people that got these ideologies, and they just want to get out here and hurt certain people that look a certain way. So, nah, I don't see no fucking change.
So my grandmother used to say all the time, especially because I see that people are saying we just need to hire more minority police officers. What is your view on minority police officers will be able to relate more with the neighborhood.
It's not nothing to do with the relating to the neighborhood, because everybody human, all right? So everybody understands suffering and things of that nature. It's a system. I dig years in the military. It's a gang of niggas in the military. Generals and all, it don't fucking matter when the system is what the system is. And as far as the police goes, I mean, it's a system. They do things the way they do them, and they have a certain way they want to go about their business. No matter who you got in office, if you came, or who, how many members of whatever race is in that, long as the system is intact, they're not going to run it. You know what I mean? Like, you'll never have a black chief, a black mayor, and a black governor at the same time, or a minority at the same time. That way you can enact change in those departments. It'll never happen. You know, so it's a system more than the personnel. You know what I mean? Like, you got to imagine, and you know, I think people will be remiss to think that there's not no black officers that didn't unlawfully kill white people, because they done that shit too. But it just ain't hit the news. You know what I mean? It's not really the cutter or the cop for the most part. It's the fucking cop. You're a cop. It's the whole entity. So I don't fucking think it matter how many people of what color is anywhere. It's just that system is built to do what it does, and it's going to do that.
How do you think being under such a harsh system, especially in your area, do you think that has a significant effect on the mental health of the people in that neighborhood?
I mean, yeah, definitely, because you move a certain way, you establish a certain view of these people, and it's either based off experience or secondhand experience, but you see it and you know how they operate if you ever have to deal with them firsthand, and it wasn't, you know, what you would think was a pleasant experience, right or wrong, if you were in the right or wrong. It's just, you know what it is. It's like, we, growing up, we are taught how to interact with them by our parents before they teach us how about sex. You know, they teach us how to deal with the police if the police approach us. It's that big of a thing, but this is nothing different from your father or his father. This is a condition. You know, I mean, we know how this shit go. We've been taught how to fucking operate with these people. It ain't LA, it's everywhere where they have badges and we are pretty much under whatever the fuck they say we're under. It's nothing new.
So, I had this issue myself. How do you balance, as a father, how do you balance when you have that talk? Because I had it, you know, I was given that same talk about how to interact with law enforcement. How do you balance the sense of urgency without instilling a sense of fear?
Well, I don't know if it's a fortunate thing or if it's a good or bad, but they have all the access we have. They see it. So the conversation is different, because now it's pretty much a conversation. I don't have to introduce it. We watching the same news. We on the same social media. You're getting the same information I'm getting. And all I can do is explain it to you from my point of view. But I think now that in these times, the kids get to see it firsthand and establish their own ideas of, you know, how to deal with this shit and how to, you know, survive these interactions or whatever. And, you know, what's different now is even the things that we were taught is clearly not saving too many people. You can do everything that your mom and daddy taught you to do when you run into these people and still not make it home. So it's just a different thing. You know, we see them like you would probably see a lion. If you was walking outside, you saw a lion, we see them the same way. Like, that's dangerous and I don't want to deal with it. And I think everybody pretty much feel the same way about it. I don't know too many people that know in what instance you would even call them to help you. I don't know what it would take for me to call them.
Yeah, I somebody broke it. I was telling Neville, a few years ago, somebody broke in my house and I just cleaned up the mess. I'm like, I'm not calling the police.
Well, I mean, what else then do, right?
When you sit back and you think about the stuff that's happened, you know, just living in South Central, people think when you live in the hood that it is all bad all the time. What were some of the highlights of growing up in South Central?
I mean, it's just like I said, it's like everything and everywhere else. You know, you live in a certain house that some people on the outside may be like, oh, that's privileged, and they don't know, but they don't know how y'all interact with each other and how y'all smile and party when the music on. It's the same thing, like LA is bombed. The Lakers win many a championship. There's a lot of parades. There's a lot of celebrities. There's always a lot of stuff going on. So, it wasn't torture. Like, you don't know. We don't see it as bad as you guys would probably see it looking from the outside. And that's, you know, anywhere. Like, I'm sure kids in Afghanistan ain't tripping like we tripping. When they putting them kids in Ethiopia on them commercials, I mean, you know, they don't even know they trip, that they got it as bad as they do, because it's just life. You know what I mean? For them. And I feel like it was the same for us. We was just there, and, you know, we dealt with what we dealt with, and we got through it if we could. But we experienced this loss and joy just like everybody else, anywhere else.
When you, what made you decide to make music again?
It was something that was missing. It's just always been something that was there, and not doing it wasn't really, it was something that I chose to do, but it wasn't under circumstances that were ideal. So once things kind of cleared up a little bit, I was able to get back to it. I did. And it was this time around, it was just different because it wasn't no expectations, wasn't chasing deals or fame or nothing like that. It was just like, I can do it on my terms. So let me just do it on my terms. And I'll do it till I just don't want to do it no more. It's just as simple as that. It's just something that I have to do right now. And when I don't have to do it no more, I won't do it no more.
Who were some of your biggest influences?
Musically, I mean, shit. I mean, as far as rap music, Ice Cube was very heavy. Nas, Scarface, growing up. But, you know, just the whole art of it, just the poetic portion of it, just, you know, even the competitiveness, like I could put words better together than you, always inspired me. And the fact that you could tell your story in such a way, and just being there from where it was to what it is, and just seeing it grow in all these different facets, it's just so much inspiration just to be a part of it. And, you know, the thing, just the fact, you know, that it was a time where you wouldn't be able to be heard unless you had all this backing and all that, to now where you reaching people all over the world. Like, people press play on your music, the numbers might not add up to what people, you know, consider fame or famous or whatever, but just the fact that you can find my music wherever you are and press play and enjoy it and let me know that you liked it, that's definitely inspiration. I mean, you can't really ask for nothing more.
Are you looking for fame, or is it just
Nah, I'm not interested in fame at all. I'm just interested in getting music to people that want it, that want my music, and hopefully just growing that from what it is. I wouldn't know what to do with fame or being famous, and I'm not interested in that. I mean, you know, it's a business as well. If my business is more in the green than it is in the black or in the red, then that works too. I wouldn't want to be famous. I'm not trying to do it for famous. It's really for the art of it and the fact that I can do it on my turn. Mm-hmm. Now, if it's, you know, like, of course, if it becomes bigger than what I anticipated, we'll deal with it. But that's not the goal. One second.
Yeah. Remember, the show is Powaful Impact. Who are the three most influential people, either personally or professionally, that provided a powerful impact in your life?
My grandma, definitely, number one. Then my daughter is definitely number two. And as far as the third, I would have to just say the whole just fucking hip hop, mainly the rap music component of it, but just the whole, just being around for that whole renaissance and seeing it and seeing all that it's turned into and what it's meant to me has been very, I mean, it shaped me. It led me to certain decisions and kept me out of certain situations because it was here. So, yeah.
What do you want your legacy to be, either as an artist and as a man?
As an artist, I just want, you know, just to show people that you can do what you do at a high level, as long as you focus on it and you got the confidence to push your agenda. And as a man, I just want to be known as a good human being, somebody that tried. And, you know, that's pretty much it. Like, I try not to rub people the wrong way. I try not to be a villain in nobody's story. And, you know, if I'm known as a good person, somebody that, you know, that spoke of in high regard when I'm not in the room, that works for me.
You're always very supportive of other artists. What's the etiquette? Because I often see artists supporting other artists, but it's not always return.
It's like anything else. If you don't do it for the return, like if I like your shit, I come across it, I'm gonna try to share it because I liked it. And also being an artist and, you know, knowing what support feels like or knowing what lack of support feels like, it's like anything else. It's never whack to just do something dope for somebody else. I mean, it's almost a no-brainer for me now. I'm not gonna push anything that I don't like. That's not hating or anything. It just didn't resonate. But if I like it, I'll fucking share it. The etiquette is don't ask me to fucking share it. Okay? Work for your shit. Don't tag me and put me in shit that I don't know what's going on or hit my DM something about and we don't follow each other. There's no kind of fucking communication or relationship. I think that's whack. You know, and anybody watching this, I would tell you, if you're an artist, don't focus on fucking other artists. Focus on fans. Don't fucking try to get support from other people doing what you're doing. It really don't make no sense. If they like and they, you know, they come across and they want to, you know, salute you or whatever, that's cool. But we all got the same job. You know what I mean? Like, it makes no sense. Focus on people that like the music and not other artists.
Yeah, my dad used to make boxes. And he was the only one in the warehouse who knew how to make the glue for the boxes. And they kept trying to get him to train people, and he'd always leave out an ingredient. He was like, I'm not going to teach nobody else how to take my job.
Why would you?
They got, so this is been wonderful to catch up with you.
Likewise.
I want you to spend this time and talk about your project. Tell people about it, where they can find it, any shout outs.
All right. Well, first and foremost, shout out to the Nothing to See Here production. Shout out to Daryl Dion, my brother Club Dynamite, Smoking Aces, D-Less. You know, they handled all the production on this joint. You can find it at Bandcamp. Look for Nothing to See Here Productions. Look at Whatup Vern, and it'll be there. It'll be there exclusively for the time being. It's a dope project. You know, I mean, I don't know how to fucking sell it. It's, you just press play and get it. It's a vibe. You know what I mean? It don't pretty much fit to no box. But if you enjoy good music, got about 33 minutes worth of time, press play on that. When I holler at me, hit me up on Twitter at Whatup Vern. Instagram, Whatup Vern, and there's links in the bios for everything after that. And we'll connect. Holla back. I'm very interactive with people that want to interact with me.
And I'll make sure I put all the links in the description. Make sure y'all check out this album. It is so dope. It is such a vibe. it is Vernon at a level we haven't seen him, with the sound that we haven't heard before, and it is so worth spending the money on. I really appreciate you taking the time to come and talk with us. We don't get very many West Coast people, and I hate that, because I feel like there's so much dopeness in the West, and it should be highlighted more.
We'll get there. We always gonna get there. And I thank y'all for having me.
All right. I want to thank everybody for watching Powaful Impact. I want to really thank Vernon Hayes, Whatup Vern, for coming in. He knows he's welcome here anytime. He has been nothing less than supportive of me. I've seen the way he is supported and honors other artists. He is one of the sweetest people. And I hope everybody takes the time to support this album. It is going to be worth every minute.
Yes, ma'am.
So this is SP. Neff.
What Up Vern has made a powerful impact. We've made a powerful impact. You go out there and make a powerful impact now.
Boom! Boom, indeed. Thanks for having me.
All right, everybody. Like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell, and we'll see you on the flip side. All my people OG.